Holder from North Providence, Rhode Island. Welcome, thank you for listening. This brief message will be just a few little comments on salvation, which is obviously a basic issue. I'm not going to talk a lot about it, but there's just a few points that I would like to make about it. So I hope that you will find it useful. And before that, we thank you again, Father, for this time together, and we ask that your blessings will be upon this message. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. So, salvation. You want to spend eternity with God. I mean, that's basically what it's about. A lot of people have this idea that salvation, somehow we have to be saved from God. And really, that's an incorrect notion. That, you know, people have this idea that, you know, that Jesus is almost kind of the, he's kind of a go-between. You know, he comes and he says, oh, you know, the old man is pissed off. You got to work with me on this one, you know, and just, you know, believe this thing so you don't go to hell, type of thing. And it's just not a good way to understand salvation. You're not being saved from a wrathful or vengeful God. You're being saved from separation from a loving God. You don't want to be separated from a loving God. That's what you want to be saved from, that eternal separation. But in Christianity, very often we've turned that around and we turn God into someone who's not loving. And, you know, Jesus came to be sort of the good cop and the Father is the bad cop. And that's totally not true. And people might even object to my characterizing it that way. But if you look at the way descriptions of God the Father come along in certain areas, and the way Jesus is described, it's almost like that. It's like, you know, Jesus is trying to protect us from this angry old man, right? I mean, that isn't true. God loves us. He's disappointed with certain things for sure, but I mean, God never stops loving us. So the salvation is not from God. It's the separation. We want to be saved from being separated from God. It is a choice. You can accept God through faith in Christ and the Son of God and in His shed blood, or not. It is a choice. It's not that, you know, everybody, the salvation work has been done through the shed blood of Jesus Christ. Yes, the salvation work is done for everyone, but each one has to make up their mind whether or not they accept it. If you accept it, then you have eternal life, and if you reject it, you lose eternal life. And you know, this other debate is, you know, what's the deadline for that? Well, you know, today is the appropriate day for salvation. You leave the deadlines up to God. You know, don't use deadlines to try to threaten anybody or intimidate anybody or guilt anybody. Today is the appropriate day for salvation. The Bible also says that if you persist in your evil ways, that God will turn you over to your reprobate mind. You know, so that's even while you're still living. It's not just the moment of physical death. You know, we've been taught that the moment of physical death is, that's the absolute total cutoff. And that's up to God what the timing is. Leave the timing of confession of sin or confession of faith in Jesus Christ. Leave that timing up to God. It's not up to us to mess with the timing. God tells us, today is the appropriate day for salvation. That's how we should witness to people and try to get them to come to the Lord. If you really reject God, He's telling you, you know, he knows that even before the moment of physical death. When He turns you over to your reprobate mind, that's while you are still living. Right? I mean, that has nothing to do with the moment of physical death, as I was just saying a moment ago. You're still living and He turns you over. So He knows somehow that you're rejecting Him. So how do you get saved? Well, basically, you know, people come up with different things that you say, or it's something that you believe. You believe, basically, that the way it has kind of crystallized for me is that you're saved when you say that you believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, and that He redeemed us through His shed blood. I mean, that's basically the idea. If you believe those things, you truly believe them. I'm not talking about a false confession, because there are false confessions as well. But when you've truly believed that, then you have eternal life, which means now you've accepted the way to the Father, who is Spirit. You know, the way, Jesus Christ, to the Father, who is Spirit. So then you've got eternal life. We've always had victory over sin and death. It's just a question of whether or not you're willing to accept it. And you're free to reject it. I mean, some of the theories that you see, nowadays, it's that it makes it look like, you know, you don't have a choice, that, you know, everybody is saved anyway, whether they want it or not. I mean, that you don't have to make a choice to say, yes, I believe that this is true. But what would be, there wouldn't be much point if God forced you to love him. I mean, that wouldn't be real love, would it? I mean, it's, no, God's saying the salvation work has been done for everyone, from the people that we might call, you know, subjectively and in our humanity, the people we might call the worst people in human history, the salvation work has been done for them as well. It's done for everyone. But God loves you and gives you free will to accept or not accept. He would very much love it if you accept. But if he forces you to accept himself, he forces you to love him, that isn't real love. It's like, you know, it's like, you know, in human relations, you know, a man chasing a woman or a woman chasing a man, and the other one's just not responding, just doesn't want it. You know, I mean, but, you know, one tries to force the other to love him or her. I mean, that's not real love. Well, God doesn't, God basically views it the same way. I mean, there's no, you know, if nobody has to make a choice about anything, you know, it's not sins have been paid for. It's more like God saying the fix is in, you know, and it doesn't really matter what you believe or what you believe in anything. But once you've believed in the Son of God and in his shed blood, then you are what we call in Western Christianity, born again and saved, reborn of the Spirit. You've got the new nature, and you're sealed forever. So you've got eternal life, and you've got choices you can make, and I'll go into that a little bit in the next message. You can go back right to where you were as though you were never saved. You can do that if you want, and you're still saved. And that's how gracious God is. But that isn't really what God has for you. He's got a lot more than that for you. So, you know, and he just wants you to, once you've been saved, he wants you to be obedient to the Spirit. And accept him as Savior first. There's, Lord is really, you make him Lord of your life once you've truly been saved by faith that he is the Son of God and he shed his blood. Get that right, that the salvation is about Jesus Christ, who he is and what he did. And then you make him Lord of your life. Don't, if you kind of, there's a temptation to kind of bring works into salvation. If you talk too much about, you know, what's going to happen, you know, after you get saved, and you have to make this promise to do certain things after you get saved or in order to be saved, you want to stay away from that. You don't want to get into any kind of works for salvation. Salvation is faith alone in Christ alone. You believe in that he's the Son of God and that he shed his blood for redemption of your sins. And that's basically the salvation message. Once you've got that, then you start, you know, okay, I want him to be Lord of my life. I want to be obedient to the Spirit. But don't make any promises, you know, mixing in works with anything, you know. Let's just keep it very clean and pure what salvation is. It's what Jesus Christ did and who he is. And one interesting thing that comes up in discussions on salvation, I'll just touch on it here. It's a little bit of a different topic, but it is kind of related. There's often a debate in Christianity about, you know, did God create Satan and hell? Did God create Satan and hell? And a lot of the thinking is that, you know, God created Satan and hell. But, you know, and that it's really, and I learned it in different places, but as a matter of fact, God created a perfect angel who turned himself into an accuser. So can we say that God created Satan? I don't think that's the correct way to say it. I think God created a perfect angel, and the perfect angel used his free will to turn against God. So he turned himself into an accuser, and Satan is the accuser. So why do we blame God that he created Satan? Satan turned himself into something. It's just like God creates something true, and man or Satan can twist it into something false. You know, true confession can be twisted into false confession. True faith can be twisted into false faith. Anything that God creates is true, but man or Satan, thinking in an evil way, can twist it into false, into the counterfeit. You know, and some of the counterfeits look very close to true, but, you know, there's this true and false thing. You know, we often talk about unity. That's another thing that one of the things that God has impressed upon us is to consider all of the different aspects of unity. There's true unity in Jesus Christ, but there's also false unity in man. You know, when people follow man-made rules and man's authority, you could talk about that. You could say that that's a form of unity. But is that true unity in Jesus Christ? No, that's false unity. So anything true that God created, man and Satan can twist into the false equivalent. and it's not really an equivalent, but the false version of what is really true. So I think in the end, I don't think for myself, I don't think that I can truly believe that God created Satan. God created a perfect angel who deformed himself by lack of faith, by rejection of Jesus Christ. And did God create hell? Well, God is everything good, so how could he create something like hell? I mean, man creates hell. Man creates hell by rejecting Jesus Christ. It's not, God doesn't have a blast furnace that he's just waiting to put you in and cook you forever. I mean, that's not God. What does that have to do with a loving God? Hell is what the place that man has thought up for himself because he wants to reject Jesus Christ. It's this outer darkness. It's the opposite of shalom. It's ra. It's, you know, heaven and hell, and nobody knows really all of the full attributes of these two places, but we know that heaven is of God, and that's where we want to be, and we know that hell is of Satan and the kingdom of darkness, and that's not where we want to be. So, but how could God, if God can only create good and bless, if he's totally good and totally perfect, how would he be the one that created hell? Man creates hell for himself through his thoughts and actions, and then puts himself there by deciding to reject God, the Son, through the Son of God, and through his blood. So that's a little bit about salvation and some of the implications of it, and basic definition, how to do it, what it means. And I did want to get into a little bit of, did God really create Satan and hell, or did he get a bum rap for that? And I think he gets a bum rap for that. But it's an important issue. It comes up a lot. People wonder about it. And I don't think that we should accuse God of making up things or doing things that are not of God. So I'll stop there, and thank you very much, Father, for this time together, and may this message be a blessing, and watch over the lives and of the people who will listen, and bless them, and keep them, and watch over them, and prosper them. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you very much for listening, and thank you, Betsy.